Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Crazy Faith Podcast. It's your host, Jasmine Todd, and today we have an incredible episode with Brittany Brown. Before we get into any type of conversation though, you know I have to give a huge shout out to, of course, our sponsor, Agoji. Agoji, they have pioneered the resistance apparel industry, creating pants that have personally taken my training to a whole new level. With 8 resistance bands that are in these pants, they will help increase your training intensity and are guaranteed to improve your overall performance. You're going to get faster, you're going to get stronger, and it's all as simple as putting on the pants. So once again, huge thank you to Agoji for sponsoring this episode, and get ready to enjoy. Tune in, guys. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Crazy Faith Podcast. I am your host, Jasmine Todd, and I am here with my special guest today, Brittany Brown. Hello, girl.
Hey.
Thank you for joining us on this wonderful podcast. I've got a little cheat sheet off over here to the side, so I'm gonna give a little bit of a background. If there's anything that you want to add on or anything needs correction, please feel free to fix it, because you know the internet ain't always correct. So Brittany Brown is a 200 meter specialist. She's a little queen in this 200 right now. She is currently ranked inside the top 10 in the world in the 200. She's a silver medalist in the 2019 Doha World Championships. She is an 11-time All-American, and she set the school records in the outdoor 100. Well, of course, the 100's outdoors, but the 100 meters in 11:28 and the 200 in 22:30 for the University of Iowa. Amazing. You had a very big season in 2019. You kind of came out and shocked everybody, and everybody, like, we all saw it coming as we watched you progress throughout the time, like throughout the season. Everyone was able to watch you progress, and I think that's one of the beautiful things. A lot of people don't get to see those type of progressions within track and field. Usually people are, once they're on top, they kind of stay in that consistent, like, I'm on top. And so to see somebody come and grow within the sport, I thought that was just so beautiful. And so normally I would kind of go in from childhood and up. And so I just want to kind of ask you, what made you get into track? When did you start running?
I started running, I'm originally from California. I started running elementary school. I wasn't like really running. I was doing like a school-wide track meet in fourth grade. So that was cool. I was like beating everyone. So I always thought it was fun. And then like really when I got into track was probably like high school. I took some time off in middle school. So yeah, probably high school is when I really, really started getting into it.
So you're in high school and you're starting your recruiting process. What was that like for you?
It was different. So I'm from California, like I said. So California is such a big state. And I only made the state once. We have like one big state meet.
Yes.
Out of our what is it called? Ooh. So we have league finals, we have masters, it's called masters. Getting out of masters, every time I would go to masters, I would never get out. So it's my senior year, I finally made the state. So no one was really looking at me, honestly. Like no one really knew like who I was. Like, you know, I just wasn't really that well known. And so my recruiting process, I visited a school in San Diego, I visited a school in Texas. And I visited Iowa and then fell in love with Iowa. So yeah.
California, for a lot of people who may not know, California is so competitive in track and field. That's probably one of the, I would say top three, like it's California, Texas, and Florida. Those three states are very, very competitive. They've got so much talent. And so I think it is very easy to kind of get lost in the sauce, even being talented in those states. So you got to Iowa. What was the transition like for you going from high school to college? Did you have a tough time transitioning, or was it easy for you?
It was, I mean, obviously I experienced, like, I was being homesick. I experienced that. My first time in snow, so that was different. My first time not seeing mountains, I was like, wow, it's just so flat over here. Everything, like, I didn't, like, know, like, other places did not have mountains, so that was, like, weird to me. So I didn't even know where Iowa really was on the map, honestly. Like, I could only really tell you where California is, because it's just so big. It's on one part. So it's, like, Iowa, you had to, like, look and search. I'm like, okay. Anyway, so it was different. It was culturally, you know, California is very liberal, and there's, you know, a lot of different cultures, pretty diverse. I was, you know, not really like that. So, yeah, a lot was different and a lot wasn't different. A lot of my teammates became like family. I'm really thankful for that. So yeah, I had, you know, I think the transition, I'm lucky enough, I had a really smooth, like, you know, freshman year. Like, I had my ups and downs, but it wasn't like, you know, I don't want to come back, you know, because I know people have that experience, but I love I didn't have that experience, so I was really thankful for that.
Very, very lucky. So when you set these school records, you set the school records in the 100 and the 200. Mm-hmm. What was going through your head at each of those experiences?
I can't remember the 100. I think the 100 was at Mount Sac. So Mount Sac is usually around my birthday. So we would go to Mount Sac in high school. So I would always like love to go to Mount Sac during my birthday. And then for college, like, we would come back to Mount Sac. So I'd like to go home and compete in front of like my hometown, like, fan base. So that was always cool. So I think I stayed at Mount Sac. And that was good. Like, I was, you know, ecstatic about that. And then the 200, I do remember when I said that was my junior year of college. I was just coming off injury. And well, the year before I was coming off injury. And yeah, it was that Big Tens was a phenomenal experience. I was really excited. You know, coming off an injury, coming off of any type of injury, mental, physical, spiritual, any type of that. Like, yes. You know, that comeback year is just a year. Just getting back to the line is just like, I'm just happy to be here, y'all. Y'all don't even know my story, but yeah, I was really ecstatic about that. Getting there and actually like dominating. It was a good year. I was happy about that year.
Girl, yes. I mean, you started running so well. Mm-hmm. You leave college now and you graduate and you move into this professional world. That transition for a lot of people can be very, very difficult. What was that transition like for you?
It didn't feel that much. I mean, it felt different. Yeah, I mean, yeah, it was different. It was, you know, new territory. You know, like, track is such a individual sport, but also a team sport. And as you move up in rankings and whatnot and move up in the profession, it becomes more individualized. So that was different, not having the team aspect of it. Traveling by myself was different, like not traveling with your coach, or, you know, trying to make new friends overseas or rooming with someone that y'all don't really speak the same language. So, you know, that's different. But yeah, it when I decided to do it, I, you know, with track, one of the ways we make our money is through, for all the listeners out there, I know Jasmine knows, one of the ways we make our money is through shoe contracts, sponsorships, funding from your national organization. One of the biggest ways we make issues through shoe contracts. At that time, I didn't have one. So I was just like, you know, I'm just going to go out there. Let's see what happens. You know, hopefully I get a contract. Hopefully, you know, it works out. But I didn't really know if it was going to work out or not. I was just like, you know, I feel like I'm going to try it out and we'll go from there. So, yeah.
So, one of the things we have on here, and it's always tough, but like with your progression, I feel like this is an okay answer to a question to ask. Mm-hmm. You run your first professional race and you came in last place. Yeah. I know for some people that obviously that could be mentally just have you messed up. Mm-hmm. What were your thoughts and feelings after that race?
So USA's, I was coming off USA's, it was like 2018, I believe. And my agent at the time wanted me to go overseas. And I was like, okay, cool, I'm gonna go overseas. It's my first time, like, yada, yada, yada. I'm thinking I'm about to beat all these girls, like, in my hand, like, I was coming off USA's hot. Like, I hadn't, like, I finally made the final, I PR, and I was feeling good. So I get over there, travel's different. I've never been, that was my first time overseas in general. So I get to Switzerland, I believe, Bellinzona.
I love that place. Yes.
Yeah, I love that place. And yeah, I get dead last. I remember calling my coach and like trying to find service too, because I'm like trying to, like, you know, I didn't know, like, you had to change your phone out there. It was just so much.
Yeah.
I was trying to call on the WhatsApp. I'm trying to use the Wi-Fi that was in around the area. Call my coach, like, I'm not running anymore. Like, I can't do track. Like, there's no way. Like, I was just like, I'm not doing this. Like, I just came out here and got dead last in my first, like, you know, like, first time not wearing Iowa gear. So I was hurt. My pride, you know, that race definitely humbled me. I was up here and coming there. I was like, you know, put me down there.
Yes.
But yeah, so it was humbling. It was hard. It wasn't, you know, it was more so emotionally taxing. Like, my body felt fine. It was just like, you know, the emotional aspect of it. And like,
yes,
you know, dealing with the travel, dealing with new people. There's just so much newness. So like, I think my expectations was like, I'm going to go over there and dominate all the time. And that's just what it wasn't.
It was not that.
That's okay. So I had a couple more races. By the time I got to my last race over there, it was in St. Kitts and Nevis. I think you were there in St. Kitts and Nevis. Yeah, so I did well at that last meet, and I felt good, but I definitely had to ride the waves of it all.
Yes, and so it's beautiful because you go through that experience, and then you enter your 2019 season. Mm-hmm. Obviously, like I said before, you ended up meddling. And what was that season like for you? When, at what point did you start to realize, like, you know, I can make this team, let's go to world championships, I mean USA champs first?
Probably not until the final, honestly. Like, I wasn't, like, it's crazy because I look back on it, I wasn't like thinking, like, in my head, like, oh, going to USA means I will be on the world team. I wasn't really thinking of it like that. Like, I think I mentally told myself not to think of it like that because it was just, like, too much for me. But, yeah. So, yeah, not until the final. I was thinking, okay, like, yeah, shot. I think I can make this team. Top three. Okay, like, let me calculate, like, when I gotta run. Like, you know, like, so it wasn't until the final where I really thought, like, I was running, I tell this people all the time, like, that whole season, I was running 22.6 the whole season. Didn't PR until I got to Worlds. So it was kind of like, what is going on? Because I was doing so well in practice. But even at USA's to make the team, I still ran, like, 22. Like, we, you know, by the time you get to the third round, like, I know everyone's like, yeah, you have to PR to make it, but like, most people are tired, so yeah. Like, you know, not everyone's like, some people do PR and make a team, but it's like very rarely that you PR and make the team, like maybe in the second round, first round coming out.
Yes.
But that third final, like, I think in where we were at, like, it was just, I think it was windy that day. But yeah, so I probably not until the final. I was like, okay, I can make this team. And then I remember I crossed the line. I was talking to Desiree Bryant after. I think there's a picture of me crying. I was just like, I finally made it. Like, it was just like all my emotions came out. I was like, okay, like, I finally made the team. Like, you know, I did it finally. And, you know, I think I had made the final that year. That was my first time making the final. I think before the USA's, I made it the second round, I believe. So each year I was just like, okay, I want to get better. I want to start making finals and start, like, you know, placing. So I was happy that I placed. I got second and I made the team. And yeah, the rest is-
girl made the team. Now that duration from USA champs and then leading up, it was such, the Worlds was the latest that it has been.
Wow.
How did you keep yourself kind of grounded in the mindset leading up to Worlds?
Let's see, where did I go after? I think I stayed here. Then there was a meet in St. Minsk in Russia. Did I have one more? I don't know if I had another meet. I don't really know. I can't remember. I think that I had that meet in Russia, so I was really happy. I was excited to go there. And I think that was the only meet I had in between. Keeping myself grounded, basically just doing like my same routine stuff that I've been doing, like rolling out, stretching. I added some other things into like last or 2019. So keeping that same routine and like also like reminding myself like I can still have fun. Like, yeah, I think sometimes athletes were like, we can't drink and do this. And like, obviously, like, I'm not gonna like go out and like party and every single day, but like there was like a fair going on. I was like, I'm gonna go to this fair. I'm gonna do this. Like, I'm gonna like not be such in the moment all the time.
Yes.
Like, that's one thing I'm probably dealing with this year. I'm just like overanalyzing everything. I'm just like, I need to get out of my head. But I definitely like, you know, had fun and kept consistent like with the stuff I was doing that helped me get there. So yeah.
And then we get to Doha. You make it on this world team, you're in this giant stadium, you're with the best of the best in the world, and you were able to keep up with the best of the best of the world, come out with a medal. Like, what were your feelings, what were your thoughts, what were your emotions going through each round?
Oh, God. I sometimes look back on the videos and I'm just like, wow, I can't believe I was doing that. Like, I have like surreal moments. I'm looking at myself running or like going before the race. I'm like, oh, wow, I can't believe, like, I can definitely remember like being like very intense and not intense, but like I was like nervous, but like still calm. I was trying to be that nervous calm. But going through the rounds, I remember a couple of nights, they had, before the first round, they had released the heat sheets. First round, I was in lane 9 of the first heat. So I was sick. I was like, why did they put me in lane 9? I was, like I said, I was running 226 all year, but I was like, 226 isn't bad. Like, it's sick.
Yeah.
Put me in lane 9? Like, was it random? Like, I just, no way this is random. Anyway, so they put me in lane 9, and I was like, you know, I can't see nobody. I'm just gonna run my little heart out and go from there. First round, I ran 22.4. So, and then the second round, 22.5, and the last round, 22.2. So, yeah, the rounds were. That's one thing I say about like my training, just anything. Like, I feel like I can go around. I feel like I can go back. Like, I feel like, you know, like I can just go back to back. So I'm really happy that showed. I was able to PR too. Emotionally, when I think about the rounds, like, it was just a lot of other outside factor stuff going on too, like outside the track, like. There's a lot of other stuff, but yeah, it. I feel, I was just talking, I have like a new mental health coach now, I was just talking to her, I was like, I feel like there's a lot of moments that like, even though like I'm struggling right now, I feel like I'm built for pressure. I feel like I don't know, I think about world and just like, I don't know how I did that. Like, I know how I did it, but I'm just like, dang, like, I went out there, and not even to toot my own horn. I'm not kind of.
Girl, toot your horn because you did it.
Toot my own horn, but it's just like, I think about the mental aspect of it. Like, I think about that aspect of it. I'm just like, you know, getting there and making USAs and making the team and getting to the last round. And I think about that sometimes, just like, and me mentally still staying present and not being overcome by pressure, just other whole bunch of outside stuff going on. I'm proud of myself in the mental aspect. I'm proud of myself for not like crumbling and not, you know, seeping under the pressure, because it's really easy to do that. So that is what I'm probably most proud of, like my legs. Okay, I already knew my legs had something in them, but like it's a mental part that sometimes is more daunting than the physical part. So yeah.
And I have to ask, because one, I remember sitting here and watching you through those rounds, and as you ran each round, all of us in that lobby were just like, she can do this. Like, this girl can medal, and it's just insane. Uh-huh. So we're all sitting here. I, first of all, cheering for all y'all. I done lost my vocals. I lost my voice, and I was struggling to cheer. Uh-huh. But when it came down to the finals, they had this introduction. Okay. Mm-hmm. It wildly insane. Mm-hmm. When you got to, I went for the jumps and we didn't get that type of introduction. What? Did you think anything of it? Were you just like, wow, like this is crazy? What were your thoughts when you saw how they did the introduction?
I was like, this is crazy. this is like a Arcadia meet. Like, Arcadia is like a big high school meet in California. Like NCAA's like 2.0, basically. Like the intros definitely, like, you know, it just brought the crowd in. So like even like the meets, the races I was watching before my race, I was like, oh my God, like these intros. But yeah, the intros definitely, like, you know, brought more nerves, brought more good nerves, brought more, you know, I think it just made it more fun too. Like, it brought the nerves, but also made it fun. It's like, oh, hey, like, hey, you like the intro? Like, I feel like I'm on a basketball team. They're like introducing us. Like, okay. Yes. I feel good. So it was good. I liked the intros.
Guys, please go look up, I don't care, it's got the sprints, I don't think they did this really for the distance. If you go watch one of the sprints intros for the 2019 Doha World Outdoor Championships, amazing, because track and field had not seen anything like that. We've seen, you know, sometimes some sparklers, some background, but the way that they did the production of that
was good.
Amazing. It had me hyped, and I wasn't even working. Yeah. Got me ready to go hop on a track, like, all right, guys, put me in, coach. And now you're on the medal stand, because you win this medal and you're on the medal stand. How were your emotions?
Ecstatic. I was happy. I was bliss. I was like, I think I made it. Like, I have enough. It was a good feeling. It was a kind of indescribable feeling. Like, and it was like, I remember I was getting interviewed after, and they're like, yeah, like, this is the first medal for the 200 in like 10 years for the U.S. team. And I was like, me? Been a minute since like someone's medaled the two, like definitely in the 100, the 4.
Yeah,
so I was ecstatic. Like, I was very, like, I felt like there was two of the U.S. girls on the that made the final. I was like happy for us as a collective. I was like, you know, I'm happy that we made the final. Like, you know, it's been a while since, you know, any U.S. athlete.
That was amazing.
So I was happy that all three of us made the final. So. it felt good to know that, like, we did it kind of like, I mean, I don't really know them that well, but you know, that we did it together. So yeah, it was a good feeling. It was a blissful feeling. I was feeling just about every emotion, sad, happy, excited, good tears, like it was a good feeling.
It was amazing. And yeah, the fact that you mentioned that there was three of you guys, that was, guys, this stuff was just so insane for us to be able to sit and witness, and for me to witness this. You guys did such an amazing thing, and it's opened the eyes, and y'all are back in the 200, and the 200 is such like a strange event, because it's not very many people that can say, you know, I specialize in this 200, like that. This is me. Yeah. Because most of them run the 100 or the 400 and kind of come into the middle of that. And once again, just amazing. So after you're done, we talked about before, you didn't have a shoe contract. Mm-hmm. You finally get your shoe contract. What emotions went through your head when you finally got your shoe contract, and how was that process for you?
The process was different. I feel like I think people had expectations of how it should have went. And then I had what I wanted. So I think people just, I remember like after it was like, are you signed yet? Like it was 2 days after. I was like, dude, like I just got off the track. Like, it doesn't happen. Like I know it may look like it's supposed to happen that fast, but for me, it didn't happen that fast. Like everyone's story really different. For me, it didn't happen that fast. So World was in November. I signed my contract in December, announced in December. No, World was in October. I announced in December. So the process was different. Like I've never, that was my first time like signing a shoe sponsorship, and navigating like agents and talking to reps and all that jazz. Like it was different. Like I've never done that. So I would just say, yeah, it was unique. I didn't really have much to compare it off of because I don't know much people in the track world like that just yet. So and my coach, like this is his like first, like I'm his basically his first like athlete, you know, that went pro. So and so he didn't have much to go off either. So we were kind of just asking people like, hey, how's this look? Like, so it was just like a combination of things. So it was different and unique experience.
Very unique. I think everyone's experience is extremely unique, especially when it comes to track. Is not it's cutthroat sport, and it doesn't have rules and regulations of how things are supposed to go.
It really doesn't. Sometimes we're saying they're like, should this be regulated?
Some of the stuff, you know, it's just very. Okay. It's free flowing. Yes.
Now that the rules have been like this for so long, it's like, okay, just don't change it. But it's like, is this still
okay? This, you know, there's some things.
Yeah.
And there's some stuff that we do need to change. I think we need to start getting some rules and regulations in our sport because we are just all over the place. And so we come off of 2019, we're now entering 2020, everyone's excited, it's an Olympic year, and it showed us that things can change in the blink of an eye, and it wasn't even just for track and field, this was a worldwide thing that we all went through together. What was 2020 like for you? There was just so many things, from pandemic, Olympics being postponed, and the ups and downs of us not knowing what was going on with the Olympics. We had the Black Lives Matter movements going on. 2020 was a crazy year for everybody. How was it for you?
It's hard. Like, I'm assuming everyone's as hard, obviously. But I think a lot of times, especially as athletes, especially track, like I feel like we put so much of our worth in our running and placement. So when you're not running, there's no placement. It's like, okay, then who am I? What am I doing? why am I, like, you know, like,
yes,
it was a lot of like self-discovery of who I am, and still a lot of self-discovery of who I am, and what I want. It made you think a lot about the future. It made me really think, like, like, you know, what do I want after track, or what do I want to do now with track? Like,
yeah,
God forbid something else happened. Like, what can I do? What have I been doing? Like, and then some days it didn't make you want to think about anything. It just made you want to just be sad. I definitely was one that was stress eating. I am a stress eater. So I definitely divulge. Okay, gotcha. I'm not the only one. I am the one to divulge into food. And I am stressed out. So that definitely happened. It sparked. And I had one outdoor race that year at Drake. I got dead last again. So it was different because it was funny. We were talking about me getting dead last my first time going pro, or first time riding without Iowa gear. And the first time I ran my Adidas gear, I got last. So I was like, dang, I was sick. I was so sick. Like, I was hurt. Like, I remember, I think I ran that Sunday and I went on vacation that Monday. Like, I was out. I was like, I'm leaving. Like, like, I was hurt. My pride was hurt. I was definitely, like, embarrassed. I was just like, how am I going to be out here my first time running in some Adidas gear and I get dead last? Like, but with all things happening within that year, it, you know, like, this is, that's just where I was at. Like, you know, I decided to do that meet, you know, on a whim. I was like, oh, let's just do it. And I did it. And it was hard because during that year, you saw so many, like, athletes, like, doing so well. And, like, these people PRing. And then you saw yourself. You're like, I've never been here like them. So it's like, it's very easy to compare and, you know, feel less or without, especially with social media. So, and everyone's, you know, with the pandemic, like, so I train at the university still. And, you know, for like a month, I wasn't allowed on the track. I wasn't allowed in the weight room. So everyone's was different. Some people still had the track, still had the weight room. Some people didn't. Even now, some people are still in that gray area of training. So, so mine's just different. So, 2020 was hard. There's a lot of self-discovery, a lot of, I was listening to the podcast that was saying how, like, finding yourself, it's not really finding yourself. It's more so about remembering yourself. Mm. And I'm just resonating with that. Cause I'm just like, I feel like sometimes, like, you know, like, we're always like, look at you, do this, and yada, yada. She's like, no, just sit down, be with yourself for a second. Like, every tool that I need, whether it's like my faith or, you know, therapy or like mental health, like, I literally have that all at my disposal right now. Like, I could, like, you know, I could write in my journal right now. So it is like a remembrance part that you kind of have to that is still transferring right now. There's a lot of stuff that I'm trying to, like, remember and tap into. But yeah, 2020 was beautifully hard. Tragically hard. So, but still beautiful at the same time, because it's just like, like, it was so painful, but it was like, it's a good pain. Like, you ever get a massage and it's like good.
Yes. Like, it hurts.
Yes. Like, it hurts. It was interesting. So
yes, definitely. I feel like that's been the theme from everyone that I've talked to, is 2020 has seemed to be a year of growth. And it, although it had plenty of negatives, a lot of people have been finding those positives out of 2020. And I think that's so beautiful. And it kind of seems like a lot of people needed that year off, to be honest. Although, of course, we would have preferred it in better circumstances. So now we're in 2021. How is training going? How is your mental going into 2021?
Training's going good. I've been having, it's funny that we talked about ups and downs. I've been good. Like, I've been mentally probably a little off, but like, I think like with the, like I said, like with the, I feel like sometimes we just want to do everything. Like, I want to do this, that, and yada, yada, yada. But sometimes it's just like, I just need to sit down with myself and just really self-examine. Like the other day, like, I was doing something. I was stressed out about something. I was like, what? Like, what is wrong? Like, what's wrong, body? Tell me what's wrong. Let me know what's good. Because I was about to stress eat. Because I'm like, you know, why are you stressed out? And I remember I had to have this hard conversation with someone. And I was like, okay, that's why I want to eat. I don't want to eat because, you know, I'm hungry. I'm just stressed out because, you know, and I feel like food's going to fix it.
Yeah.
So I was happy in that moment. I was like, okay, like, good. Like, I was able to, like, really assess, like, what was wrong with me and what I was feeling, my emotions. I wasn't acting on it. So yeah. I think those, like, mental, when I talk about, like, mentally I'm off, like, it's more so, like, figuring triggers and not always acting on them and realizing that, you know, these are emotions and that they're here. And, but sometimes they're not real. And sometimes they are real and there's some things you just can't control. So, and you being okay with not being in control.
Yes.
That's one thing I'm really focusing on. Like, you know, when I look back on like 2019, like when we talk about remembering myself, like, there are a lot of things I just had no control over, like, and there are a lot of things I did have control over, and I'm proud of that moment mentally because, you know, I was okay with not being in control, and I'm remembering that I can be okay and not be in control, and, like, you know, having God be in control, having my faith, like, you know, to bounce back on and really, you know, dive into that or whatever I'm using as a tool, so... Yeah, training's been good. I'm gonna start outdoor season probably in like end of March, run some relays, and yeah, get to that.
Yes. Okay, outdoor season. Outdoors. It's crazy because outdoor is really about to be starting up here.
I know.
Like, when did it come this fast? I'm just so confused how this happened.
Yeah.
Oh, hello outdoors.
Yes.
So I have a fun fact here that I want to share with everybody. You have a twin brother. What is it like having a twin brother?
It's different. It's funny because we were talking about getting twin tattoos, so
that's precious.
I know. And he brought it up. Usually he's like, don't talk to me, but like, I was like, oh, you want a bond with me? I knew you'd love me.
I know you would love me someday.
Okay. Having twins is cool, it's different. I was always a sickly kid. I had asthma, eczema, allergies. Actually, I still have all those things, honestly. But when I was younger, it was more devastating on my life. But, yeah, we weren't as close because I wasn't really allowed outside much. So, you know, he would do his thing, I would do my thing. So, with all my siblings, honestly, like, we've gotten closer as I've gotten older. So, we don't have any twin telepathy. Sometimes he'll call me, like, are you good? I'm like, no, I'm good. Oh, I just felt myself. I don't know what you're going on, but thank you. Pray for me. You know, maybe you know something, I don't know. Bet, cool. But yeah, it's good.
Who's older?
I am by a minute.
Oh, okay.
A minute.
That's one thing. I want twins so bad. I've got some twin cousins and I just love twins. You guys are so beautiful. Like,
my mom, it's funny because I was just talking to my mom about like having kids eventually, and she was like, oh, when I found out I was having twins, I cried for 2 weeks straight. I was like, surprise. She's like, I just didn't know how I was gonna do it. I was like, oh dang.
I made you cry, huh?
But you know, it's understandable. Like, I could, if you know, now looking back, like, that would probably be stressful, like,
yeah,
you already have one kid, like, you know, navigating finances. Like, kids are expensive.
And then you get two at once.
Yes. I think about like two graduations, two proms, like two of everything. Like,
two of absolutely everything. Oh my goodness. And having, especially when you're babies, like,
yes.
You're crying, the other one's crying. How do I?
How do you manage
that? And yet I still want twins, so
yeah, me too. Yeah,
I'm crazy, so it's fine. All right, so on to the next question of, what does a day in the life of Brittany Brown look like?
Day in the life? So like today, like this week, so I have really bad period pains this week of my period, and this week I was out, like, I was like, I'm like, it gets me bad. So this week, you know, we go the week before, because usually when my period comes to, I'm very, very emotional. So week before, typical day, I practice around like 11. I lift 3 times a week. I volunteer twice a week. I'm currently in school. I'm getting a certificate in medical billing and coding. So,
okay.
Yeah. So I do that. I do the classes and the work for that. So, yeah, Netflix. I'm a big podcast girl. Like, I love a good podcast. Like, just hits me right in the heart. I mean, I have my little notepad all the time. I'm like writing down my sticky note. Like, oh, she said this. Like, I need to write this down, put this up. So, and then also just stories. Like, I'm just like listening to people's stories. So, yeah, podcast, cooking. I usually like, I'm not a meal prep type person. I know a lot of athletes are. I would rather just like, I like to cook and listen to podcasts. I don't have to be anywhere in a rush, so like,
yeah,
you know, like where I'm at in my life right now, like I don't have to rush, and I really am trying to like really like heed into that. Like, you don't have to always be rushing. I feel like sometimes, like especially my first year out and I was working jobs, I was like, I need to make sure this and that, da, da, da. And like as soon as I feel like I'm still in that state of being like rush all the time, it's just like, yeah, it's okay, you don't have to rush,
you know, yeah,
it's slow, slow down, you don't have to be in that state all the time. So I try to be a turtle as much as possible. So I'm usually on the phone with one of my friends, siblings, so yeah, just typically what I'm doing.
On the phone, yes, slowing life down. I feel like being in the NCAA program, we're like really used to that fast pace. Everything is like, we got this, and we got to do everything fast. And we're usually always in that rush. And I think that's also the beautiful thing of once you enter that professional world or elite athlete side, whatever side you want to call it, where you get to slow things down, you get to move things at your pace. And I'm glad you learned that, because yes,
I'm still learning. Sometimes I feel like I just need to, the other day I was like, I need to get a job, I need to get 2 jobs. I'm like, Brittany, you don't need a job right now, just sit down. Like, it's okay to be with yourself. Like, you don't have to always be doing 10 bajillion things. Like, so I'm a work in progress, everyone. So just
work in progress. Yes. I mean, as long as you're working on it and learning to slow things down. I mean, of course it's always good to have like forms of income. So yeah. Yeah. I don't blame you for that. Yeah. Especially in track and field.
Okay.
Cause we say this all the time. We love the sport more than it loves us.
Amen.
And so now I'm going to get into kind of the fun questions. These are just like, I've got some random questions that I ask people. One of the first ones that I like to ask is, if you were stranded on an island, okay, islands, middle of nowhere, because some people like to ask where the island is and if there's civilization close. No, there's no civilization close. and you could take 3 items. What 3 items would you take? Any 3 items.
A water filter. A knife. Water filter, knife. Oh, what else would I need? Oh, I need something to make a fire. So, I don't know. Lighter? Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know, like, something I can use, like, to help me, signal help, so. Yeah.
I love it. These are answers that I gave, so.
Oh, okay.
I'm like, yes, same mindset, survival mode. It's just fun to hear everybody's, like, different answers, because you get people that are like, because I feel like I go into, like, straight survival mode. I think, okay. Yeah. 1800s, I'm not thinking of like these new age like technology type of stuff.
No, me either.
And some people think of like technology, and so I love to hear that we're on the same page.
Yeah, simple. I'm thinking like simple, like what I don't have to like carry it around with me, like it's not weighing me down. Like I just need three simple things. Like I need water, I need some way to get food, that's a knife. And fire, somewhere to make the food.
Fire. So, yeah, got to cook food.
Yeah.
This is why I just knew. Okay, so another question. If you can compare yourself to one animal, what animal would it be?
Turtle.
Oh.
I just feel like I'm a slow person. Like, I when I talk about myself, I just feel like, even like a track, like, I feel like I'm a slow and steady type person. I take a lot of time getting out the car when I'm going shopping. I'm just abnormally too slow. Like, sometimes I just be like, hey, you're just out there, like, so yeah, a turtle. I like my shell, I like my space. Like, I like to, like, I feel like turtles like to go out and have fun, but a turtle has a place to go when it's ready to go. Like, it has a home, like, built. I like to go out and have fun, you know, let's kick it, yada yada yada, but when I'm ready to go, I'm ready to go. Like, I don't want to be by myself too. So
I like this.
It's like I'm an extrovert introvert. Like, I like my space and I like to hang out, but you know, not too long. Like, let me go back. I actually have a sign in my house that says, "Welcome to our home. Please leave by 9 p.m. So I'm very much like, okay, you leave it.
Oh yeah, because
yes,
you're welcome.
Yes, I'm done socializing. I hope you got the vibe. I'm done. Like, but I like it. I do. But once I'm done, I'm done.
Yeah, definitely. I feel that 100%. I love that. I actually like. I don't think I've ever heard anybody say turtle, but that is a really good one. I really like that one, Brittany. That was good. Okay, so my final question. So we've got a lot of track events, right? We've got different groups, different personalities. Out of all the different events, what event group is the funniest?
Oh, throwers are hands down the funniest. Oh my God, the funniest people I know. Like, they're hilarious. They can, I don't even know how funny they are, but, and they're so cool too, though. Like, I remember in college, like, I used to sit next to this thrower, like, on the plane. Like, you're just so cool. Like, you were just, like, he was so, like, calm about everything. I'm over here. He was all older than me, but the throwers, bow ties, like, they're really funny to me. So, I don't know why they're so funny, though. Like, I feel like, I think it's so close, though. I feel like with other events, like, especially with girls, like,
yeah,
a little catty sometimes, but the throwers, like, they cheer each other on, they want the other person to do good. Like, and not saying that we don't, but like, it's just, you can tell the different type of love they have for each other. So
yes,
yeah,
it's like not afraid to, they're not afraid to show that love. Even while they're competing, they show that love to each other. On the track, it's like a
no, it's not.
I love you, but like, it's understanding. It's definitely an understanding.
Yes, I'm like, can we ever cross that line? I don't know if we could ever cross that line. But then I'm just like, can we as sprinters be as close as the runners? Like, is that a thing, or is that just,
you know, one day I just, maybe we could just start changing the culture of it.
We could try.
I don't know if it's gonna work, but like,
me either. That's why I said we could try. But
it's hard try to this, so. But I would love, honestly, I would love to see the sprinters kind of go into that same mindset, because we got some great funny personalities within the sprints. It's just, yeah, especially the females. Yes, we can get a little catty. That is very true. I think we all know and understand that too.
We do.
Well, Brittany, thank you so much for coming and joining us. I'd have to give you your compliment though, because I love your dimples. Okay. Yeah, you, I have this thing for dimples, but your dimples specifically, they just make me so happy. Like, I love when you smile and your dimples gorgeous. But yes, I had to throw that in there. Thank you so much for coming on this Crazy Faith podcast. I know we've had to reschedule a few times, and I'm so glad we were able to make this work. Thank you. I'm so excited to see you compete and get back into it.
Me too, for both of us.
Yes, I can't wait.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Crazy Faith podcast. Once again, I want to give a shout out to our sponsor, Agoji. With 8 resistance bands built in, Agoji's resistance pants have pioneered the resistance apparel industry, helping increase your training intensity and improving your overall performance. Get faster, get stronger, and it's as simple as putting on the pants. So once again, I really hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and I can't wait for you guys to hear the next one. So make sure you like, comment, and subscribe, and remember, maintain that crazy faith.